Hi everyone, I'm Joel Kettleton and welcome to Disciples in the Shed. Tonight, coming to you from my shed, which is actually my garage. Tonight we have a great panel of people who are going to be helping us think about what it means to be the church today. We've got Graham Stanton, who's the lecturer at Ridley College in Practical Theology. He's also the director of the Centre of Children's and Youth Ministry. And Graham's going to be helping us think about engaging as church in the digital space, as well as engaging with young people at the moment. We also have Wayne Chan, who's also from Ridley College, who is the digital content producer. And Wayne's going to be sharing from his experience and his expertise about how we as the church engage in the digital space. So follow me and let's go in.
Hi.
So, this is a great old hymn written by a guy called Philip Bliss, who also wrote Man of Sorrows, not the Hillsong version, and he wrote the melody for It Is Well With My Soul, and he was at a church meeting with one of the great 19th century preachers, and he heard this sermon illustration. There was a ship coming into shore during a storm, trying to find the harbour, and the captain could only see the lighthouse just. And he was trying to find the lower lights along the shore to guide the ship in. But unfortunately, the lower lights couldn't be seen and the ship hit the shore and everyone died.
That's very sad.
It is. The preacher then turned to everyone and said, the master, Jesus, is the lighthouse. Our job is to be the lower lights, pointing people to Jesus, bringing them safely to him, which I think is a really great discipleship song.
Yeah, it's called Let the Lower Lights.
Brightly beams our Father's mercy from his lighthouse evermore, but to us he gives the keeping of the lights along the shore. Let the lower lights be burning, send a gleam across the way. Some poor fainting, struggling seaman, dark the night of sin has settled, loud the angry billows roar, eager eyes are watching, longing for the lights along the shore. Let the light brother. Some poor sailor, tempest tossed, trying now to make the harbor in the darkness, may be lost. Let the lower lights be burning.
Well, it's great to have us all here. On my right, I have Jamie Bester. Do you want to say hi and tell us a bit about yourself?
Sure, yeah. My name's Jamie Bester. I'm the assistant minister, hanging out with Joel, or Joel likes to say partying with Joel. I'm also church planter down here in southern Tassie, Southern Beaches Anglican.
Next, I want to introduce Graham Stanton.
So I'm on faculty here at Ridley College. I am a lecturer in practical theology and I direct the Centre for Children's and Youth Ministry.
Excellent. And we have Wayne Chan joining us as well. Wayne, tell us a bit about yourself.
Yeah, so I'm Wayne Chan. I also work for Brian Rosner indirectly. I'm the digital content producer here at Ridley.
You directly work for him.
My role mainly involves developing videos for the Ridley Online program. But more recently, in the last couple of years, my role sort of has moved to a much more creative role in trying to produce creative content to bring about the awareness of what Ridley does, that is to train men and women for Christian ministry.
Great. Today we're thinking about what does it mean to be the church in these times, particularly in the digital space. Before we do that, I just wanted to know how it's been in your context over the last few weeks and months. So Wayne, can you tell us a bit about how you've been going?
Yeah, so I get that question a lot these last few weeks. It's been tiring, I have to say. I work has just ramped up so much more for me, but also just in a different way. So it's not really in some ways it's business as usual for me, but in a big sense, there's a lot of extra stuff that I've have to take on, and a lot of it has to do with helping other churches, other pastors, other Christian leaders. Giving them advice on how they can take their church services onto a digital platform, a bit tips here and there. So for example, I've done a few webinars on how you can get the best video quality out of your smartphone if you didn't want to buy a camera and you just wanted to, start delivering digital sermons immediately. In fact, this Saturday, I'm actually heading down to Stephen Tan's church, Regeneration Church, to help him also consult in his filming setup, just to get a much better filming setup for him as well. So a lot of my work actually revolves, around that sort of thing. It's quite, I suppose, engaging in that sense. Just not very insular looking at just what Ridley is doing, but also just helping the wider Christian community, helping everyone stand on their own two feet, that sort of thing. Yeah.
Graham, what has it been like for you in your context in the last couple of weeks?
Yeah, my Ridley work, in one sense, not a lot has changed because most of my teaching is online anyway. So I've got a bunch of students that are across the country. Certainly it's been challenging for them as they manage their own changing church context, supervising learning from home, all that sort of stuff, that changes just the dynamics of their study. But also I live here on the campus. So to work from home, like I I sort of always work from home, technically. So not a lot has changed in that regard. But, of course, everything has changed. And so personally, there's just been that managing the whole psychological challenge of isolation and COVID-related anxiety that just, you know, is laid upon everybody. In my church involvement, I'm involved with the youth ministry here at St. Jude's in Parkville. So we've got a little group that meets after the sermon on Sunday morning. There's about 8 to 10 teenagers. So just connecting with them. So we've been trying to manage the how do you do the Zoom thing, how do you do safe ministry online with teenagers. And then also I work with the leaders that look after the Friday night youth group, and we've been again just talking with them about how do you do engagement in this new sort of space. So in one sense, not a lot has changed. In another sense, well, of course, everything has changed. We're enjoying spending time at home with our young adult children. That's been nice. They're always at home.
Yes, what a great thing. Hey, Jamie, normally you're the one asking me how I'm going on this thing. So I'm going to ask you, how are things in your context?
Yeah, actually, I've been really surprised how well people have made the transition across to digital platforms and even just, I guess, one of the things as pastors we're always thinking about is how we equip people to do ministry, not only coming and hanging out with us on Sundays, but how they're doing ministry through the week and how they're loving one another. And I think one of the big things for me has just been how people have transitioned into that pretty well, actually. And I think that's a real joy and a great encouragement for me to see that, you know, you kind of don't see the benefits of some of the work you do until things like this happen. And so I think that's been really joyful to just see that happen. Digitally, we've moved across to online services. And again, I think that's really been a really joyful period where, you know, we tend to, you and I, Joel, kind of have six churches and we're doing all different things. But at the moment, we're kind of all together hanging out and kind of working together. And that, I think that's been really good fun, actually. I feel really energized at the moment just because people are engaging with the content. And you know, I can say too, you know, Wayne has spent a lot of time down here with us, helping us get on top of this stuff before this happened. And so again, God's been really good in equipping us for this time. So I'm kind of really enjoying this period in some ways, but I have to say I'm really yearning to be back hanging out with people and doing life together. Yeah, I can't wait for that.
Hey, Wayne, as someone who works in the digital space in ministry and for churches, how have you seen the last couple of weeks as far as church and the digital space? What have you learned and how has the church adapted?
So I think that's a very complex question because I think that, you know, that there's from my point of view, I've seen there's a few levels of response that have been happening for the last, you know, few weeks or however this thing has been going on for. I think when it first started, everyone was just sort of in a panic mode, right? Like everyone was just, this is, we just need to get by this week and then the next week and then the week after that. So everything was just very short term. How do we just get address the immediate this week? So in that sense, you saw this great rush where everyone just all of a sudden wasn't questioning about, oh, should we do digital sermons or not? It wasn't a question of if we should do or not. It's a question of how we should do it. So, and that's been very interesting for me to watch because I've been in this space for a long, long, long time. And you tend to get a lot of pushback. You know, traditionally, people push back a lot about the ideas of taking church online, you know, or even like doing small group online or some form of online engagement. Traditionally, I think Christians have been quite hesitant and not, you know, like they wouldn't completely reject it, but at the same time, you wouldn't get a quick 100% buy-in. Whereas this time it was, you know, I would say it's a 95% buy-in. And you saw this great fusion and collaboration with just everyone in church. Everyone's just pitching in, willing to help out and make things happen. And you know, you saw people just setting up forums on Facebook, wanting to help each other, people producing resources and sharing resources with each other. So that was really, I guess, really encouraging to watch at the same time. I think what I've noticed in the last couple of weeks is we've gotten to that stage where I think churches have also sort of flattened their own curve in a way, where people have gotten into a routine. People have gotten back some sense of normality, which is just to keep doing with the live stream stuff. So I would be interested to see, and I would like to encourage people at the same time as well, to start to be aware of that, too much of that normalcy, just because I think, you know, just doing online church really is just not the normal. Like, it's, you know, there's no way. I mean, I love my digital platforms. I love digital media forms and all that sort of thing. I'm really obsessed, you know, with all sorts of digital media forms. But the one thing I would say is that online church is just not the norm. Like, we're, as human beings, we're not created to live our full potential and our full lives via a screen. I think, yes, you know, like, digital technology does help enhance some of our lifestyles. It does help give us sort of a bandage aid in times of need, like we are now. But I think I would caution against just having that too comfortable routine, you know, with doing online stuff and actually, you know, feeling like we should feel uncomfortable and continue to feel uncomfortable doing church online, and actually look forward to the day we can all get back together in person. Yeah.
And Graham, as this is part of your area of forming people theologically, how do you see the digital space and church?
Yeah, let me pick up on something that Wayne said about the reluctance of churches to pick up technology. Like, I sort of get what you're talking about there, that where people have been pushing us into, why haven't we done this earlier? And there are a lot of people who are really celebrating the fact that, oh, finally church has gone online. Finally, we're breaking down that sort of, you know, clergymen standing up in front of a room of people sitting in rows, and we can get back to, you know, more organic, what church is always meant to be, or the sort of stuff. Interestingly, historically, the church has actually been often at the very forefront of technological change. If you think back to the Reformation and the use of the printing press, certainly the advent of radio, one of the big things that changed the nature of particularly youth ministry, was the way that Christians used radio to do evangelism. The early days of the internet, you know, there are, churches didn't do the video church gathering, but internet resources, online Bibles, all that sort of stuff. There's been a whole lot of churches taking up the technological opportunities for advancing our mission, which, you know, the New Testament is a record of distance education, distance learning, really. You know, Paul wrote his letters largely to bring his personal presence across a distance. So it wasn't the same sort of letter that we have today. It was more like a script. Somebody would read it, and they probably read it out with the same sort of intonation that they heard Paul dictate it. It really was a technology to overcome a limitation, so that they might advance their ministry. So I think the church does do that generally well, but the as Wayne said, the danger is that we get caught up too much in what we are able to do without thinking about the, well, what ought we do, what, like, why are we doing this? And really to dig back into our ecclesiology, our missiology, our understanding of what is it that we're actually here to do? What's the center of our mission? And that's a question that times of rapid change can either push that question totally off the table, and we just, you know, act out of our anxious, we've got to do something type mode, or it causes us to really stop and dig deeply into our theology to ask, okay, how do we continue to be church? We've just got to do it in a different sort of way, you know? So I think where churches have really asked those theological questions, I think it's been wonderful, you know? Conversations around communion. The how can we do communion, I think, well, certainly in a lot of the circles I've been in, has really focused on, well, hang on, what is communion? And therefore, can we do that by distance? And it helps us to really clarify what our particular theological commitments, core commitments are.
Jamie, as someone who puts together weekly content to grow disciples, can you help integrate some of what Graham's talking about with your theological convictions, how that shapes what you do?
Yeah, sure. I pick up on a couple of things. I think I read a report a couple of years back now where I'm drawing what I remember here, but I think the report stated that of the 11-year-olds in our church today, only one of three will stay within the church community. And I think that's, you know, that's a really scary figure. If we think about the fact that we're trying to make disciples, we're trying to reach people, but actually the people that are already within the church communities, we're struggling to keep them there. You know, the young children and young adults, we're struggling to keep them there. And I think one of the things I want to say about digital content right now is I think the reality is that young people are engaging in digital media. That's the reality. And I think if we don't think about how we're going to engage them in that way, then potentially we've just got our heads in the sand. So I think that's the first thing. I want to say, I want to clarify that by saying, actually, you know, as I particularly in the New Testament and the early church, you see one of the fundamental ways people are changed is by God's power in community. And so this importance of community. So the question for me is kind of, how do you create a community in a digital platform? And I don't think you do. I think it's both. I think we need to, what I'm learning lately, and I think this is another really important point. I think right now is the time where we can learn about young people and we can learn from young people. I think good questions right now will help us grow so much in our understanding of how to be the church for young people just by asking. And I think all too often we just kind of go, yeah, I know what they need, rather than I'm going to ask them what they need. And so I think engaging young people right now is important. But I think engaging them in a digital sense is what we're doing okay right now. I think coming out of this is the hard part. How do we then connect those young people that we're engaging with right now in their platform? How do we engage them with community and help them to see that God's family, God's community is the fundamental way that their lives will be transformed for God's glory and God's kingdom? I think that's the big question for us as the church moving forward.
Graham, as this is your area, can you help us with some ideas about engaging young people at the moment, and as Jamie said, transitioning out of this?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Jamie, when you talk about the way that we're engaging in young people's platforms. And, you know, in one sense, here's the opportunity for the teenage gamers to come out of the darkened corners where they're playing online and help set up a church's, you know, AV systems. You know, there's perhaps untapped resources that we haven't engaged with before. So that's, you know, that's a good thing. But, you know, though we do know that young people engage online more than older generations, that's certainly true, but the vast majority of the people that young people engage with online are the people that they see during the day. So it's not like, you know, that idea that young people are sort of living in this totally virtual space that's disconnected from face-to-face relations actually isn't being borne out by the data. It's that young people are extending the face-to-face relationships and community into the online space as well, and there's a real blurring of those two. I think that's what's really interesting. Okay, so I think that the danger would be that we mistake a connection for communion, in that sense of, yes, we're able to connect with people with resources and online meetings and the like, but how much are we actually helping people to really deeply engage with each other and engage with God in those spaces? That has to remain a key question. Because connection is not just the thing, it's how do people relate to one another and to God within those settings. And so we need to make sure that we're asking that question of young people now. So that's a one thing for now, and how we then extend that into the future to make sure that we're continuing to do what we really want to do. It's not just that young people come to youth group that is transformative, or that they come and they're part of the, you know, that they turn up at church. Okay? But it's the dynamics of what's going on there. I was asking a bunch of youth leaders the other day, we're in a research project that's thinking about the questions of how do young people experience God? How do they come to their understandings of God? And we're asking about now, in this time, how are youth ministers seeing young people experience God, and how are young people understanding God within this context? And what surprised me, although sort of not, didn't surprise me, or sort of surprised, not surprised, that so many of the people I asked, they didn't know. And it's not that they didn't know that they were trying to work it out, but they couldn't find out the answer. It's that they didn't know that they didn't know. They hadn't asked that question. If I'd asked them how many young people are turning up to the online youth group, then they all knew. But that question of what actually is going on spiritually for young people in this space was a question that we weren't asking, or a number of the people that I was talking to, we weren't asking. And look, I'm not saying that in an accusatory way. I think that's part of the challenge of this time, you know, working on building the connections, but not asking the deeper questions. So keep on asking the deeper questions, okay? But then the other thing to learn then for us, for the wider church moving forward, is to think not about this face-to-face embodied space and a virtual space as two different things, but how are they connected? Okay? So there's a great book, it's on my shelf somewhere, which is right next to me, Beyond the Screen by Andrew Zersky. That's worth paying attention to, written about youth ministry, but I think has got a lot of valuable principles for ongoing ministry. And he talks about the myth of leaving your device at the door. You know when you go to youth group or camp and there's a bucket, put your phone in here and then we can get on with being face-to-face rather than virtual. Once this ends, it can't be a, well, put your phone in the door and then we can engage, because it doesn't really recognize that the connectedness of these two worlds. So I'd be wanting to ask the question, how in our face-to-face communities can the online connections supplement, resource, continue to enrich those relationships? And the simple thing is creating a WhatsApp group for your home group. So when somebody doesn't turn up, you know, it's like, oh, where's Jono tonight? Oh, I don't know. Oh, well, we'll follow him up afterwards. No, you just send him a message. Say, you know, we're meeting, we're about to pray. How can we pray for you? So he's still part of the group, even though he's not physically present. That's one of the advantages that I think we can learn about the way that young people are using the online space to engage with each other. That was a bit of a ramble, but I hope that sort of touched on those things that you were asking about. I've sort of forgotten now.
That's okay. Wayne, I'm just wondering about creating these connections, particularly with young people. We'll start with young people. Using the space that we have at the moment, the digital space, and then integrating back into this two nature, in person and digital, what are some of the things that we could be doing now to be doing that well and to prepare for that next phase?
Sorry, do you mean by next phase meaning when we all get back?
Correct.
Together. I think that's the multi-million dollar question. And I don't necessarily have like a black and white answer for this. I think what I could give is some clues as to how the digital medium formats do work. And I think it's probably ideal for everyone, like whatever your context you're in. You need to are going to work for your culture and for your context. So like I could give you, for example, if I was running a church in, let's just say China, WhatsApp would not be the medium I would recommend you use, right? Like as Graham said, you could use WhatsApp in your youth group here in Australia because that's what everyone's using. That's the platform that everyone's on. But in China, that's not the platform that people are using. I think they use WeChat, and there's something else that's quite popular there. That's something like a replacement to Tweet or Twitter or something like that. I'm not sure. And even then, I was actually just talking about this with my wife yesterday. So my wife researches in the religion and sociology space at Deakin University. I think one of the things that we don't put a lot of thought into is to recognize that media, whether it's traditional analog media, like your newspaper or your print or digital media, all forms of media are organic in some sense, and meaning that the media formats evolve as culture evolves as well to suit whatever methods people want to use them for. So if you think back on Facebook, when Facebook first started, like I don't know what it was, like 15 years ago, it feels like an eternity. It really was a platform, a social platform, for people to connect with each other on a grassroots level. That was all it was. And over the years, as Facebook got corporatized, got bought in by X, Y, and Z. I don't know what the history of it is. Its model also has changed to not just being a social platform, but more of it's become more of a news gathering platform. So I think if you ask a lot of youths in the, Gen Z era, your current teenagers, I think they would probably view Facebook as more of a platform where they would get their news information from. Whereas people from our generation, we would still look at Facebook, oh, it's a way for me to connect with my peers that I've lost since high school or whatever. So you have to recognize that even on one platform, there may be multiple perspectives and users for that platform. So, I would just encourage people to actually think in their context, what works in their setting, what's going to be the most convenient, and all that sort of thing. I think that's really the best advice I can give at this stage.
Mm. While you're talking, Wayne, just thinking about how we use this media at the moment, as someone who's a professional in this area, can you give us a couple of tips about how not to use this media? Most of the people shooting are my age and above, and we see this format in one way.
Yeah.
Give us a couple of really good tips just to communicate better and to facilitate community better.
Yeah. Are we talking technologically or are we talking like philosophically?
Your choice, mate.
well, I mean, look, I've got a bucket list of things people shouldn't do. You know, off the top of my head, the first thing I ask people, you know, like, you know, when we're talking in the technical space, there's two things I would like people to stop doing. I would like people to stop doing videos where, you know, their web camera or camera is like way below their face. And, you know, the camera has to be angled up to look at their face and we can see their nostrils. I don't know if you've seen that. It's just, you know, it's just not the most sightly thing. That's one simple thing people can fix. The other thing is just get good audio as well. Bring yourself close to the mic. Nobody wants to hear someone that's like, you know, this far away from the microphone, because we're all trying to, you know, like the aim of all this is that we're trying to connect with each other intimately. And the way you speak, you project, the way the camera captures your voice matters as well. So, you know, I think it would be nice if people come closer to their mics and we can, you know, feel their presence close to the camera. You know, that's on the technical aspect. I think on a philosophical aspect on the way people use media, I'd like to say, you know, sometimes less is more. One of the things I'm seeing a lot is that churches, you know, some churches have continued to deliver 40-minute long sermons. Pastors have continued to speak at the same volume as they would in a church setting. So that means, you know, they're projecting their voice really loud. They're shouting over the microphone. And I think that's, you know, that's just not necessary. There's no need to yell over a microphone because, you know, if you speak close to the microphone, we all can hear you know, the preacher well and good. 40-minute long sermons, I don't think it's necessary. I think people's attention span really maxes out at about 15 minutes. And I think so anything above 15 minutes is just pushing it. So that's just an example of what I think people are doing wrong, in that we try and... So it comes back to Graham's point. We think too much of what we are able to do, and we're not thinking enough of what we ought to do. So ought you to be delivering 40-minute long sermons? Ought you be trying to replicate every single aspect of church and trying to deliver that across onto Zoom or, you know, onto live stream? Ought you even to be doing live stream? I would even, you know, put it out there to people. I know, like, we're all sort of coming, we're all expecting social restrictions to come to an end. And maybe this may be less relevant. Although, you know, like maybe on the church space, we may still see digital church services last through for the rest of the year. You know, who knows what the future may bring. But I think we still need, even after this whole epidemic ends and we go back to normal church services, I think we need to incorporate their culture. Ought we to be doing this? And I think, you know, even going back to the reformers, going back to, you know, early church history where Christians have used technology to their advantage, it wasn't so much because they wanted to do it just for the sake of the technology itself. It wasn't just so because we can do this. It's more of, it's the conviction that's within that I think that the most compelling message is the gospel. And I'm going to use whatever means I can, however best I can, to bring that message to the ends of the earth. I think we need to recapture that in our digital space.
That's fantastic. What is the call to action then for the church today? Jamie, I'll start with you.
Sure. Yeah, look, I think I was pretty impacted by what Graham was saying there about bringing those two kind of things together. You know, we're connecting with people, but how do we bring that into the community space of gathering together as God's people, not only on Sunday, but through the week? I think my call to action right now, and mainly because I'm experiencing that here, is that I'd really love to see us as pastors and leaders of the church giving young people a voice. I think this is a time where we can learn a lot from them. I think this is a time where we can learn a lot from what they need and what, you know, that, like I said, that figure scares me that, you know, there's young people in our churches that won't stay I think we need to listen. We need to give them a voice, and I think in some ways we all find that easy to give them a voice. I think the next step is the hard part, and that is to actually be prepared to make some changes based on their feedback and their information. I think it's very easy to just listen. It's much harder to change. So, yeah, I think that's what I'd be calling us to right now, is thinking, what can we learn from young people, and what do we learn about young people during this period?
Great. Graham, call to action?
Yeah, well, I'll certainly echo those things that Jamie just said. Listening to young people, learning from young people, allowing young people to take their place in the building up of the church. That's my song sheet, so I'll echo that. The simple thing I would say is I'd encourage people to take a deep breath and reconnect with your why. Like, why are you doing this? Whatever it is that you're doing right now, punctuate it through the day. Just take a deep breath and ask, why are we doing this? And either it will give you renewed energy for the thing that you're doing, but which is harder because of COVID-19 stress, or it's going to help you slow down and stop just scurrying down a path of, well, we can do this, but hang on, why are we doing this? Is this really the best thing that we can do with our time? Wayne and I have been banging on about this. We can't just recreate what February was like. We can't even anticipate that going back to normal is going to be normal, because I think we're beginning to realise that normal is going to be different. So we're going to need to keep on asking that question, why? What is at the heart of our ministry? What is at the heart of discipleship? What's at the heart of the gospel? Keep asking that question, and that will both, I think, re-energise us and redirect us. And perhaps even include some things that we're going to not do. And that would be helpful also. Hmm. But take a deep breath.
Excellent. Wayne, call to action.
Yeah, look, I ditto to everything that Jamie and Graham said. I think that's right. Like, you know, we don't know what the next few months is going to be like. It's really, really hard to determine what the future of the church. I mean, we do know that the church will thrive. It will continue to survive by God's grace. That's for certain. But the shape and how we need to transform our ministries, that's still uncertain. I think that needs to be on every leader's part to remain, I suppose, in some sense, flexible, nimble, to be able to adapt to new changes, but still hold on to the core of the gospel. I think that's something that we have to hold on very strongly, and that's something that's our rock and it doesn't change. I think more practically, I would like to encourage leaders to prepare for the day when our lockdown restriction ends, to very deliberately reconnect physically with people one-on-one. There are some stats in the education space, like in the online digital education space, from some of the friends I've been talking with, in recognizing that even though you can build relationships on digital platforms and in the digital space, relationships are not really, they're not really solidified or fully baptized until the point where you get to meet with people face-to-face. So, we can do all these Zoom chats and WhatsApp texting and all that, but until we meet each other face-to-face, we have not solidified that friendship with people. So I would say, as a lot of small group leaders or pastors, as we continue trying to build relationships online, prepare for that day where we need to deliberately reconnect with people one-on-one. And I think that's going to take a lot of energy, a lot of out of leaders and pastors to do that. But I think it's going to be so important, because that's when you want to refuse those relationships and really take it to the next level and beyond. And you don't want to miss that out.
That's fantastic. Thanks, Wayne. Hey, Graham, would you pray for us as we finish up today?
Yeah, Yeah, I'd love to. Thanks. God, our Father, we do acknowledge you to be the sovereign Lord and our good and kind Father. And we hold on to your promise that you are constantly at work and that you are using all circumstance to shape us to be more and more like the Lord Jesus. We thank you that whatever circumstance we find ourselves in, that you continue to be at work by your Spirit in us, shaping and changing us, both individually and as a community. Lord, we hold on to those promises and we pray that even in this time, especially in this time, that we would be alert to what it is that you are doing and that we would fall in step with that work of your Spirit. So, Lord, we thank you that we do live in this time of your history that gives us all of these tools at our disposal. What an extraordinary gift it is. What a different experience, Lord, this would have been if we had encountered this in the early 1990s, before the advent of all of this online technology. So, Lord, we thank you for the gift of it. But, Lord, we pray that you would help us to continue to be led by all that you've revealed of yourself in the scriptures, that we might connect with those deep questions of what our core purpose is, what it is that you have placed us here to do. And we would see these technologies as great servants rather than masters. So, Lord, please remind us of those core practices, love for you, love for our neighbor, the call to faith and hope and love grounded in the news of Jesus, who was crucified and has been raised to powerful life, that we have been brought into by the work of your Spirit. Lord, all these things, would you ground them deeply into our hearts? Lord, please continue to bless these brothers and sisters in the Southern Beaches and all across Tasmania, all across this country and across the world. Would we continue to shine as a light for the nations, that people might come to know life in the Lord Jesus? We pray for your blessing on all that we do and think and say. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, thanks so much for your time and the great input that you guys have put in. We really appreciate it. Thanks, everyone, for joining us this week for Disciples in the Shed, and we'll be back next week. See ya.